Well, we're going to read this morning from Revelation chapter 9. You can find it in your bulletin. You can also find it in your Bible. It's perfectly safe to handle the Bible in church. That's official. So, Revelation chapter 9. Let's hear the word of God. When the Lamb opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. Then I saw the seven angels who stand before the throne, and seven trumpets were given to them. And another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer, and he was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints on the golden altar before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints rose before God from the hand of the angel. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it on the earth. And there were peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we've been working our way through the book of Revelation, we've been reminding ourselves that the entire revelation that we have before us is given to John in one day, and that one day was the Lord's Day, that is, it was the day of Christian worship. And on that day, John is given, by way of vision, to participate in the earthly worship of seven churches that are named in chapters 2 and 3. And as we have observed in studying those seven letters to those seven churches, the letters are received and heard as the word of God to those churches in the context of their earthly liturgy. Then immediately we were taken up to see that what we see on earth, the earthly reality, is only a shadow and a copy of the heavenly reality. When we gather here in this room to worship God, Lord's Day by Lord's Day, we are gathering as part of, a kind of offshoot of, the heavenly worship that goes on all the time, as it were, in glory. And we were led to see that in chapters 4 and 5. And we were led to see that worship is directed by the Holy Spirit, and it is offered by the church to God the Father and to the Lamb, that is, to God the Son. In the context of worship, there is a scroll mentioned. The scroll contains further revelation by God for the church. So far, all we've done is see that such a scroll exists, that it is the scroll of human destiny, and one by one, we've noticed the seals of the scroll being broken. The scroll itself is still all rolled up. We have yet to see what is in the scroll. Only this book will tell us what's in the scroll. It has to do with our final salvation. But as each seal is broken, we have seen revelation given to us about things that are ongoing in the world right now, even as we speak. Four writers of the Apocalypse, they bring with them trials and tests designed to purify the church. Although the world's affected by these things, it's for the purpose of purifying the church. That's how you're to understand wars and epidemics, pandemics. Those things are happening in the world, and they're affecting the world, but they're affecting the world in this age for the sake of purifying the church of God. God is far more interested in what he's doing with his church and with his people. The world feels the impact, but the church is in the spotlight of heaven. We heard from the martyred saints who've been slaughtered. We heard them offer their prayer, "Oh Lord, how long, how long?" And then we had a glimpse of the saints in glory, chosen and known by God, complete now and glorified in his presence, offering their songs in a crescendo of praise. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne. And now we come to the seventh seal. And when the seventh seal is broken, there is silence in heaven. If we were following the evangelical kind of way of simply looking at the Bible and saying, what kind of personal or immediate applications could we have for this? Well, I can think of one, and that would be to challenge you to sit for the next half hour and not say anything. Well, I know you well enough that you couldn't do that, so I'm not going to do that today. I'm going to fill the empty space for you. But there are two things in this passage, two movements in this passage that I want you to notice because they're absolutely crucial. First of all, the heavenly silence, and then secondly, the heavenly commerce. The heavenly silence. We remember what this scroll contains. It contains the Word of God, which is gradually going to be opened up by the hands of the Lamb. The Lamb himself is otherwise known as the Word of God, by whom God made the universe. He is opening up the scroll which contains the written Word of God for the church. And it follows this, the opening up of this scroll and the silence that follows introduces us to a period of preparation for hearing the Word of God, listening to the Word of God. Because what is the posture of those who have come to listen to God? Well, it is the posture of silence. It's the posture of preparing our hearts to receive and to hear. To hear, you must stop speaking and you must listen up. That's the way this works. God speaks, I listen. I am silent. This is the way it was always. Whenever God was present with his people, Psalm 46, "Be still and know that I am God." So there's silence, but there is not nothing going on here. At one level, it takes us back, for example, to the silence of eternity. In eternity, that is before, from our perspective, that is not from God's perspective, but from our perspective, before there was time, before there were things, before there was us, before there were angels and archangels, there was God. God in the Trinity of his sacred persons, God complete, perfect, happy, in the beatitude that is his proper life. Until God spoke, there was silence. There was silence because there was no talking going on. There weren't three people talking to each other because God is one. And just like you don't have anybody else to talk to, even when I've told you, you need to learn to talk to yourself as a part of Christian discipleship, you know that nobody's going to talk back to you because there's only one of you, so nobody talks back. So in God, there's nobody to talk back. God is of one mind, one will, one purpose. God doesn't have a voice box to speak anyway. He doesn't need to speak. God as God is one and thinks, wills, acts as one. So there was silence until God said, "Let there be," and everything that there is, a universe teeming with life, angels, archangels, men, women, creatures of all kinds, planets, asteroids and so on. The whole universe came into being when God spoke. And when God speaks, there's not only the original creation, but there is also the new creation. God is about doing something new. So when the children of Israel were standing at the Red Sea, and God was going to act on their behalf, he comes to them and he says, "Fear not, stand firm, see the salvation of the Lord. He will work for you today, and you have only to be quiet." To be quiet. When God is about to work, his people are to be quiet. When the enemy comes in like a flood and God has to act as a warrior for his people, we read in Habakkuk, "But the Lord is in his holy temple, let all the earth keep silence before him." Or in Zephaniah, be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord, that is the day of judgment, is at hand. Or in Zechariah, be silent, all flesh, before the Lord, for he has raised himself. That is, he's got up to act on behalf of his people. He has raised himself from his holy dwelling. So whatever God is going to act, whatever God is going to speak, then we must be silent before him. So in Acts chapter 15, when the church is gathered for that first great general assembly of the church, all the assembly kept silence when listening to Barnabas and Paul preach the word to them. And even when God is about his will in judging the world, he says to the nations, Gentiles and Jews, listen to me in silence. So when the Lord starts to speak about the new creation, when he starts to speak to us as he's going to in this scroll, the posture, the proper posture for us is that of expectancy, preparedness, and silence before him. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, "The church's silence is silence before the word. In proclaiming the word, the church must fall silent before the inexpressible." Cyril of Alexandria said, "Let what cannot be spoken be worshipped in silence." So we have the heavenly silence before the word of God. Then secondly, we have the heavenly commerce. Now we understand what commerce is. It's trade. It's the movement of goods and services from this to there and so on. And that's what I'm speaking about when I speak of commerce here. Here's what we read in verse 3. "Another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer." Now we've noticed as we've gone through Revelation that what lies behind the earthly reality of worship and ritual and liturgy and service to God is the ultimate reality of which the earthly is only a copy and a shadow. So the temple of Israel was meant to reflect the heavenly realm. The trimming of the seven lampstands in the earthly temple, we see that happening in chapters 2 and 3, where the lampstands represent individual churches, and God is at work trimming the churches ready for the service. In the temple of Israel, there was the altar of sacrifice, of the Holocaust, where the lambs are slaughtered. And in chapter 5, we saw the lamb freshly slaughtered on the altar, but the altar is Calvary, and he comes into the presence of God. There's the pouring out of the altar of blood at the base of the altar. We see that in chapter 6. Those who follow the lamb will suffer for the lamb, and there are many who suffered and died for the lamb, and their blood, the blood of the martyrs, is at the base of the altar. Or the incense altar offering, which we see here. All these are earthly renditions of the heavenly reality. Now, the altar of incense is the only altar in heaven. There is no altar of the Holocaust in heaven because the purpose of the Holocaust is realized in Israel's ancient temple where all the animals were slaughtered, and above all on the cross of Jesus, where Jesus, the Lamb of God, was offered as a sacrifice that would put away sin once and for all. There is no repetition of that sacrifice. Hence, there is no altar of the Holocaust in heaven. We read in Hebrews, when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, for by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. The earthly temple had an altar of incense. The incense cloud, as it gathered and hung round the front of the temple, and then as it gradually moved upwards, represented a relationship between the prayers of the people and their access to God. As you watch the incense rise and you saw it creep higher and higher, you were to see your prayers were being gathered, collected up, as it were, by the incense, and were ascending up into the presence of God. It was a visual, fragrant representation of prayers being taken into the presence of God. David, you remember, prayed, "May my prayer be counted as incense before you." Now, how can my prayers be gathered up and counted as incense in the eyes of God? David might have wondered about that question too. And the answer is quite straightforward. It's because Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. We come to God through him. And through him, we are able to continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that acknowledge Christ's name. Mixed with the fragrant incense, the prayers of all the saints rise up before the throne on high. Now, it's this that reminds us then to think of this heavenly commerce, the movement of goods, if you will. And that movement between heaven and earth begins with God. God is the primary agent. So the thrust of the movement begins in heaven as God comes downward to where we are. You think of the story of Jacob running away from home, running away from Esau, and he's at Bethel, and God comes to him. God descends to where he is. He thinks he's run away from home, that he's all alone, but God comes to him and reveals himself to him. You think of the heavenly ladder that he saw. The ladder extends from heaven down to where he is. You come to the New Testament, and the fulfillment of this movement finds its climax when the Word becomes flesh and dwelt amongst us. God comes down here. And then Christ, as our representative, ascends back to the Father. And what we understand is that in ascending back to the Father, he's opening up the way by which you and I might approach the Father. Our prayers go up with him into the heavenly places. The Word of God comes back down to us. That's what's happening in the early chapters of Revelation. Here are the words of the Amen. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The Word has come to us. The Word of God has come into this building this morning to you. It's coming to you from his Word. But there's more to this commerce, because as the Word of God comes to you, your prayers are returned to God. That's the significance of the issue here. We saw an example, back in chapter 6, where those who were slain for the word of God and for the witness they'd borne cry out in a loud voice, "Sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge the world?" And as soon as the prayer is offered, an answer is given. Well, not yet. You rest for now, not yet. But when the full number of God's elect have been gathered in, then the judgment will come. The wrath of the Lamb will come. We saw that back in chapter 6. And we see this in the human life of our Lord. Even though the person Jesus was is the eternal Son, nonetheless, Jesus lived in his human flesh. He lived a human life as the God-man. He prays as the person he is, the Son of God, but he prays as a human being to God because he has become human by his incarnation. In the Garden of Gethsemane, we find the divine Son concurring in his human nature and with his human will, with the divine will that was the Son's and the Father's. That very incident teaches us that the Son lived out a fully human life and related to God in a fully human way. As a human being, he was overwhelmed as a perfect human being who would not expect to die. He was faced with death and in his human nature recoiled from death. You may do that one day. But then he teaches us that his human will is in perfect line with his divine will when he prays, not what I will, but what you will. He's demonstrating that there's no opposition, no hesitation. There is only harmony between Jesus' human will and his divine will, and that divine will is shared with the Son and the Father and the Holy Spirit. But he's praying in a human way. Having become like us, he becomes like us so that we might become like him. And what we learn from that is that Jesus and the Father were at one in this great plan of salvation. So when we pray the Lord's Prayer, what you have to understand is when we pray the Lord's Prayer, we're praying along with Jesus. He taught us to pray with him, our Father in heaven. I mean, we flatten it out. We think it's just us in this room, and anybody by live stream who might want to join in with us. So it's us who are saying our. No, Jesus is saying our Father. His Father is our Father. We're praying along with Jesus. And therefore, the church's prayers are empowered and emboldened by the prayer of the Lord Jesus. The prayers of the saints are carried upward, and the incense represents in the sanctuary the prayers of Christ himself, who collects our prayers into his. He is our advocate with heaven. He is our intercessor there. He presents our cries and tears, our hopes and fears, our prayers of that make sense and our prayers that don't make sense, the prayers that have words and the prayers that are unexpressed, the prayers that are sighs because we can't find words or we're too moved to be able to say anything sensible or logical or reasonable or rational. They're taken by the Holy Spirit and they're scrubbed and retranslated into perfect prayers that are offered on our behalf to God. Isn't that wonderful? I really prefer the Holy Spirit's translation of my prayers than mine. And that's what he does for us. And we, as we pray, very often feel like the people the Apostle Paul's talking about in Romans chapter 8, after he's talked about the Holy Spirit doing that for us, and after he's talked about Jesus as the great intercessor, captures the prayer of God's people in this quotation from Isaiah, "For your sake we are killed all day long, we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered." And now you say, I have never prayed that in fear of being killed physically. But in many ways it captures the essential prayer of the believer, because every day we face death. We need to die spiritually to the world, to the flesh, to the devil. We die a thousand deaths by disappointment, by heartache, by fear, by grief. And the reality is those are our sighs. We cry out, "How long, Lord? How long, Lord?" And we need to know that that cry is heard by heaven. Christ ushers our prayers into the throne room as his own. He owns them. He owns your prayers, your heart cry, as his own. That's always the way. So when God is speaking about the people of Israel when they're in Egypt, he teaches Moses that his action is based on their prayers. The Lord said, "I have seen the affliction of my people, and I've heard their cry, and I've come down to deliver them." God hears the cries of his people. But there's one more thing you need to see here. Here are prayers that are ascending to God. God hears your prayers. They're important to him. He does listen to them, every one of them, every sob, every sigh, every word, he hears them. But there's more. He keeps them. He conserves them. He keeps them in the great censer that we have described here. The angel took the censer with the prayers of the saints and filled it with fire from the altar. How are our prayers going to be answered? This is the question that's being answered here. How will justice be done in the world? When we pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," how that will happen is in God's hands alone. But our prayers are the means of answering our prayers. You see, the censer is filled with the incense of the prayers of the saints. And the angel goes to the altar and he takes a coal from the altar and he puts it into the censer that is bursting with the prayers of the saints. The fire of God and the prayers of the saints. You remember Isaiah's experience when he's gone into the temple and he sees this vision of God on the throne and the glory of God, and he hears the seraphim singing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God of hosts, the whole earth is full of your glory." You remember what happens to Isaiah in the presence of holiness. He becomes unglued. He thinks he's falling apart, disintegrating, dissolving there in the presence of God. And the angel is told, "Take a coal of fire from the altar and touch his lips." And he's restored and he's healed and he's pardoned. And the angel tells him, "Your guilt is taken away, your sin is atoned for." For the believer, the fire of God is nothing to be afraid of. It is a consuming fire, but it will not consume you. Moses' burning bush, you remember? God is present in the bush. The burning, flaming fire of God's purity, holiness, is present in the bush. The bush isn't burned. The holy God indwells you. You will not be consumed by him. But the wicked are not so. The burning coals are put into the censer. And the angel takes the censer and he throws its contents out on the face of the whole earth. The prayers of the saints and the fire of God mingled together are thrown out into the whole earth, and there are peals of thunder, loud noises, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. All reminders that just as God descended on Mount Sinai, because the same language is used, and just as God descended upon Sodom, so God will come in judgment These things come from the throne of God. It's the throne that's being described in chapter 4. From the throne come flashes of lightning and voices and peals of thunder, and before the throne are torches of fire. This is the throne of God acting on behalf of God's people in answer to their prayers. As our prayers are sent to God, God sends down with the prayers His holy fire on the earth to accomplish His will. So where does real power lie in our world? Where does real power lie in our world? What are the true secrets of our destiny in this universe? We're tempted to think of the sinister figures who concentrate power and wealth and influence in their hands. We think of evil despots, evil powers, and we think of satanic powers behind the human powers of this age. But the true secret, kept hidden from the world, but one day to be manifested to all humanity, all at one time, is right here. What is that secret? It is the prayers of the saints and the fire of God. More potent, more pervasive, more powerful than armies or technologies or individuals. Worse than the plagues of Egypt. It is the prayers of the saints and the power of God that is the true disturber of the peace on the planet. You can keep your theories, you can look at your totalitarian powers, you can be worried about our terrorist groups or rogue governments, but men and women in the world really need to be afraid of the prayers of the saints and the fire of God. That is the real aggressor, and that is the real solution. And that is the real mover and shaker of this age. Marx hated Christianity and wanted it destroyed. Stalin purged, he thought, Russia of Christianity. Hitler focused on the church and tried to destroy the church from within. Mao Zedong tried to destroy Christianity once and for all. They tried to stamp out the fire. But they couldn't. They couldn't. The prayers of the saints and the fire of God. Now that has something to say to us as the church. An old man like me can remember a time when churches all across the world really were quite simple. You had services on Sunday, and on probably a Wednesday night in the middle of the week, you went to the church prayer meeting. My memory of the church prayer meeting is it was mostly older people. They prayed long prayers. They quoted the Bible a lot in their prayers. And they prayed about big things. Then people of my generation thought we'd do something sexier than that. We thought we'd have small groups. I think I was one of the first people to introduce small groups into a church in place of the prayer meeting. Of course, I explained to people, we will be praying in our small groups as well. Oh, yes. I lied, not knowingly. The prayer in small groups is nothing like the prayer in the prayer meeting. What we tend to pray very often for in small groups is something you should be doing on your own, praying to God about your itchy finger or your auntie's broken neck, or whatever it may be. Those are things we should be praying about all the time, in the moment, right in the moment, sending up our arrow prayers about the things that worry about us in our ordinary everyday lives as Christians. Those kind of prayers should be going up and down to heaven all the time as part and parcel of what it means to live in the world as a Christian. But when the church prays together as church, it needs to be engaging where the spiritual battle lies, the things behind the things. Praying in earnest, as it were, before the battlements of heaven. C.H. Spurgeon said, it's as if we are besieging the battlements of heaven. We're crying to God that God would work in salvation in the lives of men and women. We don't need to know the names of these men and women. God knows His elect. He will save them. But we need to be praying for their salvation. We need to be praying against the destructive powers of this age that undermine and demolish the work of the kingdom. We need to be praying against those things. We need to be praying for the purity of the church, not just our church, but the church universal. We need to be praying that Jesus would come again in power and glory. We need to be praying the Word of God. And it needs to be the kind of serious praying that is hard to do in your slippers, because it's doing business with God. That's the prayers of the saints. Your other prayers matter, let me tell you that. We're to pray without ceasing. But all the other things. But there's a place for praying serious stuff and of praying the kingdom into action. That's what's going on here. And it's the prayers of the saints and the fire of God that were ultimately responsible for the pandemic and the wars. That's what happens when God starts to stir up and disturb the world. The world acts the way the world will act. People didn't realize how scared of death they were until this epidemic started. They didn't realize. God exposed how inadequate leaders are in every country on the face of this planet because they are terrified about death. God uses the prayers of the saints to stir up the world, as we'll see when we look further into this chapter. He uses it as an instrument to call men and women to Himself and to judge the world for its behavior. Prayers of the saints and the fire of God. Let's pray. Father, we pray that You would stir us up today by Your good word, which we've sat in silence to hear. We wait to see what You, the Lord, would do. Help us, Lord, to revisit our prayer life, our corporate prayer life, the prayer life of our groups as we meet and so on, that we would get to prayerful business with these big issues so that we see Your movement, Lord, so we can understand the movement of our times and recognize Your hand in them, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.